everybody, and a very warm welcome to LMT YouTube channel. During a surprise appearance on National Geographic's Car S.O.S, the Duke of Sussex congratulated disabled veteran Stephen Van Niekerk and described him as the epitome of inspiration. Van Niekerk, who joined the 3rd Battalion, the Rifles at the age of 21 and was injured by an improvised explosive device 7 years later, had his Jeep Grand Cherokee taken in for persistent mechanical problems. Harry's dedication to supporting injured veterans is well known, and he played a key role in establishing the Invictus Games, which is an event for wounded, injured, and sick servicemen and women. With the car renovation complete, Prince Harry took it upon himself to deliver a personal video message to Mr. Van Niekerk, in which he praised the disabled veteran's unwavering spirit and resilience in the face of adversity.
Hi, Stefan. Congratulations. I hope at this point you're sitting in your brand new, or certainly what looks like a brand new Jeep. Good on you, mate. Well done. Fully deserved. I can't think of anyone that deserves this more than you. After getting injured at such a young age, after 2 tours of Afghanistan, you are the definition of inspiration, because you are not defined by your injury. You are defined by your selflessness to others, to your community, your inspirational talks to young people, and of course to your 4 kids and your amazing wife, Sadie, who no doubt has got you this far. So full respect, well done you. And I heard someone told me that you're planning to cycle from Canada to Mexico, just a mere 2,745 miles, I think. Good luck with that. I know you're going to do it. I know you're going to smash it. And I know you're going to raise a load of money for Blesmer as well. Other than that, mate, just huge congratulations. And a thank you. Thank you for your service. Thank you for your continued service and commitment to others. I'm sure your whole family is incredibly proud of you. I'm proud of you. We're all proud of you. And there's a reason that you were chosen for this. Saddle up and enjoy your new wheels, and then make sure that you get as fit as you can for this next huge adventure that's coming your way. And then you can smash that. And at the end of that, I would love to meet you, even if it's over a Zoom. But full respect, mate. Well done. Love it. And catch you soon. Cheers.
As a person well-versed in the ways of the British royal family, one cannot help but marvel at the Duke of Sussex's unwavering commitment to supporting wounded veterans, a cause that he has championed throughout his illustrious career. The Duke of Sussex, who served as a battlefield air controller during his first 10-week tour of duty fighting the Taliban in Helmand Province in 2007, recorded a video message last year at his home in the U.S. After retraining as an Apache helicopter pilot, he returned to Afghanistan in September 2012 for a second tour. Meanwhile, Mr. Van Niekerk, who lost his left leg at the hip, his right leg below the knee, and 5 fingers when he stepped on an IED in Sengen during his second tour of the country in 2009, was medically discharged from the army. With the support of his wife and army rehabilitation, he has become a motivational speaker for Blesma, the limbless veteran's charity. His best friend, Ian, and wife, Sadie, aim to reward his bravery and positivity by helping him become an off-road driving champion with his used 2002 car. Furthermore, Mr. Van Niekerk plans to raise funds for Blesma by cycling from Canada to Mexico. In response to Harry's message, he described it as insane and expressed his disbelief that the Duke of Sussex was talking about him.
That is insane.
You alright?
Yeah.
Recognize that guy?
Yeah, just about, yeah.
One cannot help but marvel at the resilience and unwavering positivity exhibited by former Lance Corporal Stephen Van Niekerk, who, despite suffering from life-altering injuries sustained while on a tour of duty in Afghanistan, has turned his hardship into a source of inspiration for many. The Duke of Sussex, himself a veteran who has shown an unyielding commitment to supporting wounded servicemen and women, recorded a poignant message congratulating Van Niekerk and highlighting his remarkable journey to becoming a motivational speaker for Blesma, the limbless veterans charity. One is left with a sense of admiration for both the indomitable spirit of Mr. Van Niekerk and the compassionate dedication of Prince Harry to the cause of supporting injured veterans.
Disclaimer, everything in this video and all of my videos are my opinions based on detailed research that I perform. That said, I would recommend doing your own research before you make up your mind. Thank you.
Harry and Meghan just got a big wish granted, as their daughter officially received a long-awaited royal title. Here's how it happened despite the royal family rift. On March 3, 2023, Prince Harry and Meghan Markle, Duke and Duchess of Sussex, hosted a christening for their 21-month-old daughter, Lilibet Diana, at their home in Montecito, California. While it's often been speculated when and where Lilibet would be christened, royal experts always thought it unlikely that it would occur in the UK. Having the christening in the US was a choice that also reflected the preferences of Lilibet's godfather, playwright, and actor Tyler Perry.
I go, okay, what's going on? And they said, well, we'd like for you to be Lily's godfather. I go, whoa.
In the Netflix docuseries, Harry and Meghan, Perry recalled that while he was honored to be chosen as a godparent, he had some misgivings about traveling abroad for the christening.
Does this mean we got to go over there and do all of that in the church with them and figure all that out? Because I don't want to do that.
As an alternative, he suggested a small ceremony in Montecito instead. Like Perry envisioned, the event was a smaller affair with 20 to 30 guests. Meghan and Harry also kept the guest list small for Archie's christening. In 2019, Lilibet's older brother was christened at Windsor Castle with 25 guests attending. While Doria Ragland, Meghan's mother, participated in both events, Harry's side of the family was notably absent this time. Even so, the ceremony provided a royal touch in terms of Lilibet's title. It's no surprise that Prince Harry and Meghan Markle chose to hold Lilibet's christening in California, as tensions between the couple and the royal family continue to simmer. However, the fact that Lilibet received a royal title is significant, as it shows that despite the rift, the couple still holds some ties to the monarchy. It's interesting to note that the guest list for both of their children's christenings was kept small, perhaps reflecting a desire for privacy in the midst of ongoing media scrutiny. Nonetheless, the ceremony was still imbued with a sense of royal tradition and ceremony, which is important to both Harry and Meghan's identities. Prince Harry and Meghan Markle's spokesperson used Lilibet's new title for the first time when announcing her christening, saying, "I've been confirmed that Princess Lilibet Diana was christened on Friday, March 3rd, by the bishop in the Episcopal Diocese of Los Angeles, the Reverend John Taylor." As reported by People, Harry and Meghan invited King Charles, Queen Consort Camilla, and William and Catherine, Prince and Princess of Wales, to Lilibet's christening. While it is unknown exactly why the royals didn't attend, it appears they've been involved in discussions concerning the debut of Archie and Lilibet's titles. Now that the big reveal has occurred, Buckingham Palace has updated the line of succession on the official royal website to reflect their titles. According to a 1917 decision made by George V, Archie and Lilibet have had access to these titles since September 2022, following the death of Queen Elizabeth. George V's rule states that the current monarch's grandchildren who have a male royal parent can use prince or princess titles. However, Archie and Lilibet are not eligible to be styled as his or her royal highness, since Harry is no longer a working royal. Instead, these designations are in abeyance, a kind of limbo where they existed but aren't used. Royal titles can be murky. During Prince Harry and Meghan Markle's bombshell interview with Oprah in 2021, Meghan revealed her surprise when she learned that Archie wouldn't get a title. She mistakenly believed her child was being unfairly excluded.
That was when they were saying they didn't want him to be a prince or a princess, not knowing what the gender would be, which would be different from protocol.
At the time, Archie was a great-grandchild of the monarch, so he didn't qualify under George V's rules. However, to add to the confusion, Archie's cousins, Prince George, Princess Charlotte, and Prince Louis, have had their titles since birth. Although they too didn't fit George V's stipulations, another monarch intervened on their behalf, Queen Elizabeth. Since Prince George will one day be king, his great-grandmother wanted him to be designated a prince right away. She also decided to give his younger siblings the same privilege, even though Elizabeth didn't expand this title option to her other great-grandchildren. Archie and Lilibet weren't alone in their lack of royal titles. Princess Anne's two children, Peter Phillips and Zara Tyndall, weren't eligible either, since George V's declaration specifies that it's the children of the monarch's sons who could be called prince and princess. However, in their case, when Queen Elizabeth offered to change the rules, their mother declined. Looking back, Anne was pleased with her decision. In 2020, she told Vanity Fair, "I think it was probably easier for them, and I think most people would argue that there are downsides to having titles. We can only wonder what effect the new titles will have on Prince Archie and Princess Lilibet in the years ahead."
I just want them to be happy.
It is interesting to note the complexities surrounding royal titles and how they are granted. While it is unclear why King Charles, Queen Consort Camilla, and Prince William and Catherine did not attend Lilibet's christening, it is possible that discussions surrounding Archie and Lilibet's titles played a role. It is important to remember that royal titles can be murky and are often subject to historical precedents and decisions made by previous monarchs. George V's rule stipulates that grandchildren of the current monarch of a male royal parent can use prince or princess titles, but the use of the HRH designation is reserved for working members of the royal family. It is worth noting that while Archie and Lilibet are not eligible to use the HRH designation, they do have access to prince or princess titles. It is also interesting to compare their situation to that of their cousins, Prince George, Princess Charlotte, and Prince Louis, who were granted prince and princess titles despite not meeting the criteria set forth by George V. The intervention of Queen Elizabeth in granting the titles to her great-grandchildren further adds to the confusion surrounding royal titles. Finally, it is worth noting that Princess Anne's children, Peter Phillips and Zara Tyndall, were also ineligible for prince or princess titles, but their mother declined Queen Elizabeth's offer to change the roles. Overall, the complexities surrounding royal titles provide an interesting look into the traditions and practices of the British monarchy. Stop. Check out one of our newest videos right here. Plus, even more LMT videos about your favorite stuff are coming soon. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.